David Starr, the 52, wouldn't get out of the way, and I'm fucking sick of it. All right, Stacking Dennys, we're off to Las Vegas, everybody's favorite city, and if it's not, it should be. But we're coming off of the Bristol race, the Bristol night race, which ended with the guy that we thought would be in victory lane, but it ended with a lot of fireworks. It ended with some drama, and it ended up that the slowest four cars of the season were the ones that were eliminated from the playoffs. This race also got the highest rating on Jeff Gluck's poll. Nick, was that the best race you've seen over the last 3 years or however long he's been polling people?
It's up there. It's definitely up there. I don't know if it was the best. I thought it was really good. I enjoyed it a lot. I was a little annoyed about the back markers, as I'm sure we'll talk about, getting in the way a couple times, not just getting in the way, but, you know, spinning out, just whatever. Just, they're always a problem. Like, just learn how to drive. But, you know, I mean, I'm not racing in the top series, so I can't really complain too much, but still. Like, you're supposed to be a professional NASCAR stock driver, and you're getting in the way of the leaders. It's just frustrating. But, no, I did think – I thought the race was really good. I don't know if it was the best race. I mean, there's been a lot of good ones throughout the past couple, two, three, 4 years. But it certainly was up there. And, you know, it's – not only was it the top in Jeff Gluck's poll, but, like – Bristol makes up, I think he said, the top three in his all-time rankings for the yes-no poll thing. You know, not his rankings, but like the fan vote. So why they ever put dirt on that track makes no sense to me.
Yeah, and the best part is people still are defending this decision to go back and continue to go back to the Bristol dirt race. And you brought up the back markers. I'm going to go on a little bit of a rant here, because I think that entire situation with Chase Elliott and Kevin Harvick was David Starr's fault. If you watch, one, he's 18 laps off the pace. He's like 10 to 15 miles an hour off the pace every single week. I've watched this replay minimum 30 times. David Starr pinches Chase Elliott down in the corner. He doesn't even get out of the way in the beginning. And then after he pinches Chase Elliott down, which allows Kevin Harvick to get that run on Elliott to get him into the next corner and then come up and hit him. Then if you watch David Starr, that fucking shitbox David Starr, who, by the way, completely ruined Tommy Joe Martin's from winning a stage in the Xfinity race earlier this year, he almost wrecks Kyle Larson on the straightaway after ruining Chase Elliott's line. Like, why is this motherfucker on the track? I don't get it. You are 18 laps down. You do not have the right to that. You don't get to make it three wide when the leaders are coming beside you and the leaders are trying to pass you. Get the hell out of the way. If you watch the replay, the shitbox that did the right thing in that situation was Garrett Smithley in the 53. He got completely out of the way, completely out of the groove, and let the leaders race. David Starr, the 52, wouldn't get out of the way, and I'm fucking sick of it.
Yeah, it's getting ridiculous. And I, you know, I understand NASCAR wants cars on the track. I understand. We want to see cars race all the way to the end. But I'm kind of thinking, wouldn't it be great if there was a rule where, like, you take the number of laps left plus five, and if you're that many laps down or more, you're just out, right? So let's say, you know, there's 10 laps left and you're 15 laps down, you're out of the race.
Mm-hmm.
Wouldn't that be great? You know? If there's 100 laps left and you're 105 laps down, you're out of the race. I mean, if you're 105 laps down, you should be out. I mean, you know, I understand there's this whole, like, well, we could gain some points, but the whole thing I'm saying is, like, well, if you're 105 laps down, there's 100 laps left, you're not going to be passing enough people to gain a ton of points, right? So I understand, you know, in certain cases you want to, you know, guys might go to the garage and they'll fix whatever, you know, if it's not a damaged vehicle policy thing, they can go to the garage and fix a mechanical. But you're not going to make up a ton of points anyway. And what I'm really thinking it is for cars that aren't damaged, you know, for for cars that haven't been in a crash, that type of thing. Like, if there's 10 laps to go and you're 15 or more down, maybe they should just throw you the black flag at that point, because, you know, it would have avoided the whole deal, because, you know, 18 laps down or whatever, and there's, let's say there's 13. Now, maybe it wouldn't have worked here. I can't remember the exact number of laps left, but because I think, you know, Elliott was out there for a while holding up Harvick. But at some point, we got to get these slow ass dudes off the track, because 18 laps down, you know, barely meeting minimum speed, probably. Maybe they should just raise minimum speed. But yeah, I mean, that's another solution. But I'm curious to hear, you know, if you're listening, you know, whatever platform you're listening to us on, or if it's on YouTube, leave it in the comments. Like, what do you think NASCAR should do? Because this is getting out of control with some of these backmarker drivers getting in the way of things. I think a lot of us can agree to maybe raise the minimum speed, because 107% of minimum speed, which is kind of what the Formula One rule is, was faster than the minimum speed NASCAR is requiring. So NASCAR is letting you go even slower than 107% of the leader's pace or whatever. So, yeah, I'm just curious what people's thoughts are, but David Starr definitely in the way. Like you said, Garrett Smithley did a great job, much more self-awareness. We also saw, of course, Quinn Houff have an issue, which affected Ricky Stenhouse. Stenhouse had to avoid the problem there by coming down pit road, which cost him a lap, and he never ended up getting back on the lead lap when he was running in the top 14, 15, pretty much the whole day. Like, even on the very first start of the race, he climbed up into 19th and 18th, 17th, 16th, you know, and then another restart or two later, he was basically in the top 15 the whole race, top 16, top 15. And I think when the accident happened with he was in 14 or 15th place and had to come down pit road, and he was having an awesome day. Race over, you know, and that one's just a rough deal, because you had Stenhouse in your DFS lineup. Mm-hmm. You had Chase Elliott in your DFS lineup, in your King of the Speedway lineup. And both of those guys were negatively affected by backmarkers.
Yeah. And I mean, it's becoming almost an every week thing. And like you said about minimum speed, I don't understand the point of having minimum speed, because these David Starr got lapped like within five laps of the race starting. It's embarrassing. He's literally just in the way. Like, I don't understand the point of having minimum speed. These shitboxes can't even keep the draft at Daytona or Talladega. They can't even keep the draft. Like, it's just, it's frustrating. And if it would affect, again, I always default to, what if this was a playoff? What if this was the championship race? Because that's another topic we could talk about. There's a lot of people that think that Bristol should be the championship race after having this great ending. But what if this was a championship race, and or like I said, with him and Tommy Joe Martin's at Richmond, what if that would have kept someone out of the playoffs for not getting those points? Like, I don't understand these shitbox drivers and their mindset of thinking that they like own the track when they're so slow. There's no respect from these guys, and that's all it comes down. Like, I understand that you're out there to race, but there's absolutely no respect. And like I said, I'm sick of it. I'm absolutely sick of it. I've complained about backmarkers for a long time. This was my breaking point. I am completely done with backmarkers and anybody that tries to defend them, because I've had a lot of people I mentioned this year defending Cody Ware, defending Quinn Houff. These guys are shit drivers. Cody Ware's purposely wrecked several drivers this year, even his own teammates. He does not belong on the racetrack. Somebody's going to get hurt. Somebody's going to get hurt when David Starr is running 20 miles an hour slower on a mile and a half track. And you just keep, I mean, we've seen crazy wrecks happen. And I don't think people realize, when these cars are going literally 20, 25 miles an hour slower, how much of a safety factor that is. And
it's not only that. I mean, part of it is the car, right? Like, the car is junk, but part of it is the driver as well. Like you're saying, with Cody Ware, Quinn Houff, David Starr, like, they're causing problems. You mentioned Garrett Smithley get out of the way. We've seen BJ McLeod, you know, get out of the way, be very respectful, a lot of respect in the garage. I think Josh Balicki's another one, or Timmy Hill. Like, yeah, they're in bad equipment, but they know how to race professionally. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. It's the few that don't that are causing issues by and large again and again and again, and giving all the back markers a bad name, but some of it is on the driver as well. So it's really unfortunate, because I know you weren't following your King of the Speedway leaderboard, but I was looking at it like the whole race. You were top three on speed, sometimes in first, sometimes second, sometimes third, swapping it back and forth with the two guys that finished first and second. And your lineup happened to be the one that got most negatively affected of the top three. I was talking PJ. I'm like, Jordan's in great shape. It's going to take crazy shit for him to fall out of the top three, and crazy shit happened. I mean, it is Bristol, so it makes sense. Crazy shit happens mm-hmm. at Bristol. But yep. you definitely had a top three lineup in King of the Speedway based off of speed. First place in that, 100K. Second place, 30K. Third place, 20K. I thought you were set for 20K, barring Bristol craziness, which we knew was going to happen. So, you know, I was like, you know, if things somehow go to plan, you're pretty much locked up for a top three. And I thought, you know, if craziness happened, you could have potentially either easily won it or had the finish that you had, which was 14th out of 40, which, like I said, it took a shitstorm of bad luck to relegate you to 14th out of 40. I mean, you should be pretty damn proud of your lineup. I thought you did amazing.
Yeah, and that's probably gotten lost in all of this. Is I'm very happy with, you know, you and I spent a lot of time discussing strategy and mm-hmm. and you kind of getting my mind right, because like I said last week, I'm not very good at Bristol with DFS, and landing on that lineup, I as soon as the night started, I was like, I think this is going to be a really good lineup, you know, and yeah, so that just added to the frustration. Is I knew how well I was doing with that. I knew what was on the line, and that added to my frustration. But like I said, even if that didn't happen, I'd still be as pissed, because this, I'm not going to talk about back markers anymore, because I could go on way too long. But a few things. So did you agree with what Chase Elliott did? He went back out there after Kevin Harvick hit him, overdrove the corner, went up, cut his tire, ruined Chase Elliott's chance to win. And Chase Elliott went out there, and I don't think he actually hit him after he got back out there, but he definitely then went and blocked him and allowed Kyle Larson, who I think would have passed Harvick anyway, but easily allowed Kyle Larson to get the win, and then let Kevin Harvick go by. So do you agree with what Chase Elliott did in getting that revenge, or what do you think? Because we've seen Chase Elliott, you know, get other revenge before. He's put Denny Hamlin into the wall when Denny Hamlin was winning at Phoenix. He's kind of unpredictable, though, because he'll do something like that. Like, to me, this wasn't enough. I think he should have put Kevin Harvick into the wall. What's your take on that?
Yeah,
do you agree with it?
I think if you're gonna do something, you should go all the way. You know, but I think he should have done more. Like, you know, at least door slammed him into the wall. You know, maybe not knock him out of the race, but door slam into the wall because you got your tire cut. I can understand that. Now, of course, there's debate of was it Harvick's fault or not, or in terms of Chase Elliott getting his tire cut. That's a whole different debate. But from Chase Elliott's mind, he was wronged. So you got to wrong Harvick back, but I don't think he did enough. What he did do, like you said, was he held him up. And we've seen this a few times this year where teammates held up the leader to allow another teammate to catch and or pass for the win. Mm-hmm. Both Atlanta races. So Joey Logano holding up Larson to allow Blaney to catch up. Blaney, I think, had the better car anyway, but yeah. But it certainly helped that Logano held up Larson. Chastain holding up Kyle Busch to allow Kurt Busch to catch up and pass. Now, Kurt Busch, again, had the better car, but again, Chastain holding up Kyle Busch, I think, was the difference maker there.
Yep.
And now, you know, Chase Elliott holding up Kevin Harvick to allow teammate Kyle Larson to get past. So we've seen it three times this year, and I think you have to be consistent with all of them. I was okay with the Chastain one because what is he supposed to do with there? The specific situation with the Chastain was he had to pick a line. He either had to pick the line in front of Kurt Busch or the line in front of Kyle Busch. So he picked the line in front of Kyle Busch, which to me was fair. The Joey Logano one was a little more egregious, and I think this Chase Elliott one was kind of egregious as well. So I'm going to put them slightly in different boats in that I think the Chastain one was a little more fair because he had a choice of do I block my teammate or get in front of my teammate and hold him up or get in front of Kyle Busch and hold him up. The Joey Logano one, it was like Blaney was a little further back, and so he was basically just holding Larson up. And here, same thing with Elliott. He was just holding Harvick up. So I was less okay with those two, and I was more okay with the Chastain one, given Larson and Kurt Busch, or sorry, Kyle Busch and Kurt Busch were closer to side-by-side and were side-by-side basically when the holdup happened. So slightly different circumstance there, but no, I would rather Chase Elliott have not held up Kevin Harvick there and just let it play out naturally because, you know, Chase Elliott had just pitted, fresher tires, tended to be faster than Harvick all day anyway. So, you know, I think he obviously ended up pulling away later. So, you know, I think he should have just pulled away and just let Larson and Harvick race it out.
Mm-hmm. We talked at length about that after the second Atlanta race. And, you know, my opinion remains the same. If you do it, own up to it, and I'm okay with it. And the only person out of those three that owned up to it was Chase Elliott. He flat out said what he did. He flat out said on the radio, that's what he's going to do.
Yep.
And yeah, I'm all for it. That's what teammates are for, in my opinion. And I don't like none of them like slammed on the brake. Well, Chase Elliott kind of slowed down. Like he could have gone faster, but, like I said, I completely get it. To me, that's payback. You know, like the first two weren't payback. They were just being good teammates. Chase Elliott was payback. He thought he was wronged. And I know Kevin Harvick, he's fighting for his first win. That's the first time they've really been competitive this year. I understand he's frustrated. He's driving his ass off. But I'm for it. I think it's
fine too, but in the context of the 100% rule, Chase Elliott wasn't doing the 100% thing. You know, he wasn't doing the 100% thing.
Have they ever enforced that rule?
No, I don't think I've ever seen it enforced.
Enforce it, I'm going to go insane because enforce it on fucking David Starr.
Yeah, oh, I agree. Well, I'm saying like Ross Chastain in that Atlanta situation, he was giving 100%. He just had to pick which one to block. Right. So like I was okay with that one. Logano and Elliott. I guess Logano was kind of given 100% because, you know, he's trying to stay in the lead lap and yada, yada. Chase Elliott, he was not giving 100%. Like, that is the definitive one you can say he was not giving 100%, which is where I do have an issue with it. I understand, you know, outside of the context of the 100% rule, again, I don't have a problem with it either. Like you, I agree that's what teammates are for. But in the context of there isn't 100% rule, I don't think he was giving 100%. You know, he was... Now, I do understand, and people will be like, oh, well, you know, X let whatever teammate pass earlier in the race. That's not 100%. Actually, that is 100% because you're trying to make sure, you know, if somebody's faster, you're not going to let them by and try to fight them and potentially wreck. The 100% is I'm giving 100% to try to get the best finish I can get at the end of the race. You don't have to give 100% every single lap. The idea is you have to give 100% to try to get your best finish. And I don't think Chase Elliott was necessarily doing that there at the end. I don't necessarily know if he could have, I forget what the leaderboard looked like at that point in time. Could he have caught anybody three laps down and maybe passed somebody three laps down? So maybe that's a moot point, but you know, I think I definitely don't have a problem with the Chastain one. I agree with you on the owning up part. Like that was ridiculous. Logano definitely did not own up to it either. At least Elliott owned up to it, but I think in the context of the 100% rule, his was most egregious.
Mm-hmm. And I'm going to default again to the same argument. If that's the championship race, do you have a different opinion?
If I think he affected the championship outcome?
Yes.
Well, I mean, I wasn't cool with it anyway because it wasn't 100%. So I definitely wouldn't be cool with it if it affected the championship.
But would you be more pissed? More upset?
Probably. But I mean, I get your point. Like, you should be equally pissed regardless.
Right.
But, you know, I think certain things can be situationally applied. Like, I don't see Elliott doing that in a championship race. Like, I don't think we have this situation in a championship race even at Bristol. I don't think he's just going to sit there and be like, all right, I'm going to hold up Harvick and let my teammate win. Cause Harvick will fuck him next year. Just like, that will come back to haunt Chase Elliott's chances in things in the future. That's one of those things you would never forget. That's like the Logano costing Kenseth the win at Kansas. Kenseth payback style, bad level if you did that in the championship race. And that's why we haven't seen, you know, at Homestead or Phoenix, teammates getting involved in screwing the other contenders over, because you don't want that on your resume, so to speak. You don't want that to be something you're known for, because that's going to come back and bite you in the ass at the worst possible time.
I think if this was the championship race, and, you know, there's a lot of ifs here, but if Chase Elliott, Kevin Harvick, and Kyle Larson were all in the final four, that played out the exact same way. Chase Elliott cut a tire that way. I think the same thing happens. I think he wrecks him. I think he completely takes out Harvick in that situation, and I'd be okay with it. Even if the championship's on the line.
I'd be okay with it, but, you know, given that Elliott thinks he was wronged, but he's going to have to realize NASCAR probably isn't going to be okay with it, because Kenseth got a 2-race suspension or whatever it was, and big old fine. And, you know, Elliott's going to have to pay the consequences. He might have to miss the Daytona 500 if he did that.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. And that'd be massive implications, both from, you know, sponsors and
yep.
even Hendrick himself.
Oh, yeah.
So that brings up, you know, the next point. A lot of people now, and a lot of it's recency bias, but a lot of people are talking about, hey, let's move the championship race to Bristol. What do you think about that? Because I'm not a fan. I wouldn't be a fan.
No, I don't want the championship race at Bristol. I thought it was exciting. I thought it's a great elimination race, especially in round one, where there's 16 cars in the playoffs. And, you know, if you can't make it top 12 out of 16, you don't deserve to be a champion anyway, right?
Yeah.
So I'm okay with Bristol being elimination race in round one. Maybe round two, you know, I'd be okay with it being elimination race, kind of like Talladega was that one year. But I don't think it should be the second to last race of the year or the last race of the year. I don't think it should be the championship race, just because we don't want shitbox David Starr affecting the outcome. We don't want, you know, it's much less likely to happen at a Homestead or at a Phoenix. It certainly could, but it's so much less likely that these crazy scenarios are avoided of, you know, retribution and payback and, you know, shitbox cars or whatever. I think I'd be okay with it being an elimination race in one of the earlier rounds, but I don't think I would be okay with it being the championship race there. So it's just one of those things. It's really, really tough to kind of gauge, but I don't know. I mean, I'm not a fan of it. I know a lot of people were talking about it, and it was no doubt it was an exciting race. And I think we want to see an exciting championship. I thought Homestead gave a lot of exciting championship races, but I definitely don't think I would want Bristol to be the championship race. Did I stall long enough there for you?
Yeah, you did. I have this tendency when I'm drinking something to breathe at the same time, and then like the liquid goes into my lungs and cough crazy. But yeah, I don't think that would be a good representation of the true champion. Like, there's so much that you can go wrong at Bristol, and that does go wrong, and you know, just one tiny mistake completely takes you out of the race because it puts you 5 laps down. So, yeah, definitely on the same page there when it comes to the final race of the season and determining the champion. And speaking of the championship, so we're now down to 12. Eric Almirola, Tyler Reddick, Kurt Busch, Michael McDowell, all eliminated last in the first round. So we now have the four Hendrick drivers, which all made it through. We have the four Gibbs drivers that made it through. we have three Penske cars, and then Stewart Haas Racing with Kevin Harvick. And now we're in round two of the crazy round, I guess is the best way to put this, because we got Las Vegas this weekend to kick it off. And this is pretty much the only normal race we have. So we go from Las Vegas to Talladega, which we all know anybody can win there. And then we go to the Charlotte Roval to end it. And we've seen, even earlier this year at the Daytona Roval, we've seen crazy finishes happen. I know we're both gonna say who we think is gonna be out at the end of this round, but at what level of confidence are we gonna have in this? Because I think Las Vegas is pretty predictable. Talladega, literally, you know, we saw Kyle Larson blow an engine or have mechanical issues on lap one in the first Talladega race this year, which could, I mean, that could, a bad race at Talladega, if he doesn't win at Las Vegas this weekend, could potentially put him in a very bad situation to get kicked out at Charlotte. Charlotte, the third race, you know, obviously Chase Elliott's going to be the favorite, you know, if he's on the bubble. But so let's go and let's say who we think is going to be out after this round of the new 12 that are left.
Yeah. So I think this is super interesting because I think there's two clear guys I have out, and everybody else is very tough to say. And even one of the guys I have out has a win this year at one of these tracks. And that's Keselowski at Talladega. But I still think he's a clear out because it's so much harder for him to win than it is for him to finish in any of the other 36, 7, 8, 9 spots. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And if he doesn't win at Talladega, I think he's out. I don't think Charlotte Roval is good enough for him. And Las Vegas has been fine to him. But I just think that lack at Charlotte, the randomness of Talladega being far enough behind already, and really strong tracks for some other drivers here, I think Keselowski's out. I think Harvick is out. I don't think this sits up very well for him either.
Mm-hmm.
So then it comes down to, for me, a couple other drivers. It comes down to Christopher Bell. Mm-hmm. Comes down to Joey Logano. And it comes down to Byron and Bowman. So I think it comes down to those four drivers, two other spots. I'm going to say Christopher Bell's out only because, Las Vegas isn't super amazing for him. Talladega, you know, he hasn't been super duper duper strong at the super speedways. And so I'm going to say Christopher Bell's out. And then I'm actually going to say Joey Logano is out. The reason being, there's the only 750 is a road course. And yes, he's had some good road courses this year, and he's been good at the road courses, but it's the only one that is a 750. He's been better at the 750s this year than the 550s. Obviously, Talladega is a great track for him, but just like Keselowski, if he doesn't win Talladega, it may not be enough. Vegas, again, okay for him, not amazing. The 550s haven't been as good for him as the 750s. And I think a lot of drivers are going to be much better at Las Vegas than him. I think Vegas sets up really well for Kyle Busch, Kyle Larson. I think it going into an evening race is very good for Truex. Blaney's been awesome here. Bowman's been really good here. I don't see Elliott getting eliminated with the Charlotte Roval. I certainly don't see Truex getting eliminated with the Charlotte Roval or Hamlin or Kyle, but, you know, Larson, like, really, these are good tracks for, you know, especially for Elliott, Busch, Hamlin, Truex, and Larson. Two of these tracks are good for all five of those drivers, four or five, whatever I just named drivers, all five of them. Blaney, Vegas has been great for him. He's fine at Charlotte Roval. I mean, he's won here. He's had some good Roval and road course finishes. He's great at Talladega, just like his teammates are. And Bowman and Byron, they've got the speed for the 550s at Vegas. The big question will be Charlotte for them, the Charlotte Roval for Bowman and Byron. So, you know, I'm going to say Keselowski and Logano are out, but it's close with Bowman and Byron. But, you know, I'm going to say Harvick and Keselowski for sure. Bell probably. And then Logano barely out versus Byron and Bowman.
Mm-hmm. So you don't think, you know, the current top six of Larson, Truex, Hamlin, Blaney, Kyle Busch, Elliott, it's going to take something catastrophic to get those guys out.
It's going to take Talladega and Charlotte being Talladega and, you know, road course and Super Speedway being road course and Super Speedway, right. Which is certainly possible. I just think Las Vegas is really good for those top five or six, those top six, let's say. And I think Charlotte's really good for pretty much all of them as well. So, and Talladega, we know those Hendrick cars have power there. We know those Gibbs cars have power there, and we know the Penske cars have power there. So this is just the Penske, Gibbs, and Hendrick show essentially with Harvick thrown in there. So right. I think Harvick's done, but you know, I just think there's enough there where Talladega is so equal that it's going to come down to Las Vegas and Charlotte as the tipping point for me. And I think those top six are just so strong at Las Vegas and Charlotte Roval.
Yeah. The only guy that gives me question marks in the top six is actually Kyle Busch, because for whatever reason, he's struggled at the Rovals. Like mm-hmm. he's like had issues in every single race, and it could just be randomness of him not doing well, but the ovals or the Rovals, he just doesn't seem to run very well at.
He won the Clash, didn't he?
That doesn't count.
Okay. But I mean, he was running really well at the first at the Daytona Roval until
he always has speed.
Happened. Yeah, yeah. So I think it's just randomness, you know. DNFs I don't really count as much because they're DNFs, but I would rather see the true speed prior to the DNF, and I think Kyle Busch has had a lot of true speed at these Rovals.
Mm-hmm. Looking specifically at the Charlotte Roval, you know, my ex-boy Alex Bowman has finishes of fourth, second, and eighth there.
Mm-hmm.
So definitely, and Byron's been strong on the road courses this year. But going to the drivers that I think are out, I think it's going to take Bell to win at the Roval. And mm-hmm. while we've seen him do that this year, I don't think he's going to get it done. So right. I think Bell's out. I'm rooting for Kevin Harvick to get in. I actually am. I want to see him get to Phoenix. Definitely doesn't set up well for him with only having two playoff points coming into this weekend, where he's also, you know, a good run for him is finishing fifth in a stage. He's not going out there and winning stages, which is what I think he would need to do. So Kevin Harvick, I agree, out. I'm going to go Keselowski. And so we're the same for those three. And then I'm going to go Bowman. I think Bowman's out.
I think Las Vegas is really good for Bowman. And yes. Talladega, those Hendrick cars have power. And he's been great at the Charlotte Roval. So that's why I'm okay with putting Bowman in there. I think Las Vegas is a really good track for Bowman. And this is one of the points I wanted to make. I know a lot of people, and I don't want to get too much into the Las Vegas preview, but a lot of people were on Kyle Busch's opening number, Blaney's opening number, but Bowman's opening number is really good. Last year's first Vegas race, he and Blaney were battling out for the win, along with Chase Elliott. Those three were really good. This year, he had a great car at Las Vegas 1 until, again, problems. And Las Vegas last year, the second race, finished fifth. So I think, you know, and if you go back to 2019, he has a sixth in the second Vegas race. So I think, like, this is a really good track for him, Las Vegas. And he is 21-1 at FanDuel right now. Mm-hmm. So I really like that 21 number on Bowman to win Las Vegas. But I just think Las Vegas is a great track for him. Obviously, Talladega, anything can happen. And I think those Hendrick cars are pretty strong at the super speedways, just like the Gibbs and the Penske cars, which I think is great that we have three teams, three different manufacturers, where all those cars seem to be pretty strong and could contend for the win. And then, like we said, he's been great at the Charlotte Roval, fourth, second, and eighth in the three Charlotte Roval races. He brought it home 10th at the Daytona Roval this year, and last year 12th at the Daytona Roval. So he's pretty darn good at these Rovals too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know, you mentioned the first race at Las Vegas this year. I remember that very well, very, very well, because I had bets on both Chase Elliott and Alex Bowman. I actually had a bet on Chase Elliott to win the first stage in that race. And he got beat by, I think, Keselowski on the final lap.
Yep.
And Chase Elliott had the best car to start the race by far. Like, I was heavy on him in DFS that day. I talked about him all week. Nobody else was talking about him. They were both super strong. Chase Elliott gets some damage. He has to, for whatever reason, Gustafson pits him and they fix the damage. It wasn't doing anything to him. I think it actually made him faster and then just completely ruined his car. So yes, I think Alex Bowman and Chase Elliott could definitely fly under the radar this weekend for Vegas. And we'll get to Vegas a little bit later, but yeah, what do you think the chances are that that four Hendrick and four Gibbs get into the next round? Judging by who we think's out, it's basically just going to take Blaney falling out and Bell getting in, especially, yeah, you know, with yours.
I think the chances are pretty low just because Bell is definitely weaker than Ryan Blaney by a good amount in terms of their current playoff standings. I mean, Blaney's 19 points up, but also just the fact that all three of these tracks are pretty darn good for Ryan Blaney. Yes. I would definitely say Vegas is better for Blaney than Bell. I would definitely say Talladega is better for Blaney than Bell. And the Roval is probably a little bit better for Bell, but Blaney's been strong at the Charlotte Roval. Blaney's been strong at road courses. He hasn't been amazing, but he's not bad at them. You know what I mean? So I definitely think the Roval's better for Bell, but it's, you know, two races versus one, Blaney has the advantage. And I don't think the advantage is as big at Charlotte as it is maybe for Blaney in Las Vegas versus Bell.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, I would take something catastrophic because, you know, Blaney also has that 19 point advantage just from playoff points.
You say something catastrophic and that's Talladega.
Yeah.
It could hit anybody. Nobody's immune at Talladega.
Right. And that's what's going to be this round is just, you know,
if Kyle Larson gets caught up in Talladega early, you know, if something happens and he gets caught up in the first big one and can't repair that car, he could be looking at having a fight at the Charlotte Roval. Not that he'd be in terrible shape, but he might be looking at having a fight, you know, to at least points race, keep an eye on things rather than just already be essentially locked in or completely locked in.
Was it the Charlotte Roval? You remember I think it was the Charlotte Roval race that Kyle Larson like walled it on the final turn to get to advance the next playoffs on points. Mm-hmm. Oh, that
was the craziest race. Cause that was the one where Jimmy Johnson spun Truex on the last corner.
Yep.
And Blaney came through to win and Larson like walled it. It was, that was an incredible race. That was a lot of fun. And Charlotte Roval has produced some good ones, but that's because, Larson and Keselowski were leading most of that race. And, you know, as you say, Keselowski, that's kind of an interesting thing there to note. And there was a late restart and they both just sent it into the wall. Like nobody got on the brakes in time and like the whole field wrecked. But it started with first row of Keselowski and Larson. And so Larson was driving like this junk car that he had wrecked, trying to salvage any point he could. And he got in at the expense of Jimmy Johnson, who was contending for the win. If Johnson had just brought it home second, he would have been in the playoffs. Instead, he went for the win, wrecked Truex, spun himself out, and allowed Larson to get in. That was wild, wild stuff.
Yeah, that was wild. I remember it well because I did well in DFS that day. But you mentioned that the first, or the restart where they all drove it into the Tums heartburn turn, as Rick Allen would say. I'm fully convinced that I don't think they overdrove that. I think there was oil on the track, and I will maintain that because I was listening to the radio on the caution before that, and they said there's oil in turn one, and they never cleaned it up. And then all this, you can't tell me that the entire field overdrives the first turn. Like, but yeah, that is a perfect example of, you know, we have lost the only person is going to be safe playoff wise is whoever wins Las Vegas this weekend. I think this winning this race is extremely important.
I was Kyle Larson. Say that. Yes. Agree.
Kyle Larson won the first Vegas race. If he can do it again, you know, then it completely opens things, you know, wide open. Like, I wouldn't even feel, if I was Truex, you can't feel safe. You know, Truex struggles finishing at restrictor play or super speedways. But speaking of not finishing, we went on last week how Truex does not finish at Bristol. And what did he do? He comes home with a seventh place finish. Didn't lead barely any laps, but that was a very good race for Martin Truex Jr. I like to see that. Like I said, I have a lot of money on him in the playoffs this year. So always good to see my boy running well. But yeah,
Byron, man, he pulled through there. That was incredible. He did exactly what he had to do. He got some playoff stage points, finished third, and squeaked through by the hair of his chinny chin chin. And he squeaked through. But I was happy to see that too. Given I've got money on Byron to win the championship 17-1, and you're, I think, pointing out he was 30. I don't know if he still is 30-1 at points bet for the championship. I would destroy that if I could bet on points bet. Right now, obviously, I can't, but I would absolutely destroy, I'd blow that up if I could bet, because nothing's changed since he was 17-1. I really liked him at 17-1. He's still in the playoff picture. He's still about where he was, you know, several weeks ago. So I would blow that up, because Phoenix should be a pretty good track for him. If he makes it to Phoenix, he would be in contention for the championship, no doubt.
Yeah. And that brings up another point. I've been tweeting out weekly, you know, showing the different lines for not only the race, but also the championship across these books. And it's very interesting. If you want to bet championship winners. Now, full disclosure, I only have bets on two drivers right now. I have a lot of bets on Truex, and I have a couple bets on Chase Elliott because he's at 10-1 right now. But it's interesting to watch these, and this is another reason that I'm posting these odds every week. One, I'm tracking the movement each week, and two, I'm showing how different books can be. But if you want to bet championship odds, and you don't think that the driver that you want to bet on is going to win the next race, it's almost better to wait until the race is over and then bet them. Because what we see with these books and how they do these championship odds, Kyle Larson pretty much stays the heavy favorite the whole time. But there is a ton of fluctuation with these other drivers. When Denny Hamlin won at Darlington, you could have got him at 9-1 before Darlington. After he won it, he went to 5-1. And now before Vegas, he's back to 7-1. They overreact to these wins. And it's kind of like a buy the dip, you know, with crypto. I love betting drivers for championship odds when, one, if they're struggling, like Truex in the middle of the year, he got up to 11-1. There's no way I was passing that up for Truex. And also, if they're facing elimination, that's another time I like to bet these championship drivers. If they're on the outside looking in, going into, like, if Martin Truex Jr. would be on the outside looking in, going into Martinsville, you can bet I'm putting significant money on Martin Truex Jr. to win the championship, because he's going to be like 15-20-1. Because if he's in a must-win situation, yes, you need that to happen, but we saw it last year with Chase Elliott. He needed to win Martinsville. He did. Then he went and won Phoenix. So just my point here is, don't overreact. Like, if you want to bet Denny Hamlin, don't overreact and bet him a week after he wins like he did at Darlington, because you're going to get a much better number. Even as these playoffs go on and as he gets more likely to make it to the Final Four. There's definitely a very good chance that these lines can shift. We see it every week, and I'll continue tracking it. So make sure you you pay attention to that, and you know, just get the best lines possible. That's what we say every week.
You have to stick to your priors and adjust your priors for new information, of course. But I don't see anything that's going to move me off my prior that William Byron at 17-1 is good value. If I think that's good value at 17-1, and my modeling said so, I haven't seen anything that would suggest that, you know, 30-1 is bad value suddenly. And like you said, shop around, because Circa, the book in Las Vegas that I think has pretty sharp lines, has William Byron at 15-1. And I think that's much closer to where he should be. And, you know, 30-1 is just absolutely bananas. But you were talking about, you know, you've got two outrights, or two, I should say, futures on championship futures. I have Truex like you, and I have William Byron, and I have Kyle Larson to make the final four. So those are my three futures championship or make the championship bets that I have. I have Kyle Larson to make the final four, and I have Truex at 9-1. 850 or 9, and I have Byron at 17-1. Those are the bets I have. So sticking to those. I might look around and see what value I can get, you know, here or there, but I'm not necessarily done with those. But right now, that's what I like. If I can find in some way, shape, or form, like let's say Logano has a really bad Las Vegas or something, and he's a gazillion to one after Las Vegas. He's great at Talladega. Anything can happen at Charlotte Roval, you know, he could be right back in it. And then, you know, the next round doesn't set up great for him either with 2 550, ovals, but Martinsville is pretty good for him and Phoenix should be pretty good for him. So, you know, Logano is another one I'll be keeping an eye on if, things get, you know, get out of hand with him as far as his odds there. But, right now, I'm just sticking to the bets that I have for the championship.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and like funny you mentioned Logano, because I was on him several times last year when his odds went longer because of, you know, like a mid-round struggle. And the good thing with a lot of these books, if you bet this value and they get to the final four, most of them's going to offer you a cash out option as well. So if you want to cash some of your bets out, there's a lot of money to be made there, I think, on, like you said, if you think that they can win the championship now at 9-1 and they move to 21-1 or something like that, or William Byron at 30-1, I'm with you, makes absolutely no sense, because we're starting a new round. What's changed? He had a bad first round. Doesn't matter. Does not matter at all. So yeah, it's ton of value out there, and you know, that brings up a second question I was thinking about today. So Kyle Larson's so heavy of a favorite to win the championship this year. We both do not like betting heavy favorites. I wouldn't recommend betting Larson for a championship at this point. Do you think it's wise to kind of load up on these other drivers at 10-1, 12-1, 15-1, to where you have the most likelihood of having three of the four drivers in the final four at 10 to 1 or longer odds? Or is that just dumb?
I wouldn't necessarily load up, but I would be looking for value. Everybody from Truex down through Logano. Then Keselowski, yeah. Bell and Harvick, I wouldn't look for value. You know, somebody tweeted Harvick at me, Harvick, you know, 24-1 or something. I was like, nah, sorry, just no. So there's a point where it's like, what's Harvick done this year? Nothing. He hasn't won a stage. He's led the most laps in one race. That was New Hampshire, where the rain took out a couple of the contenders. There's definitely a point, but I think anybody from Truex, Hamlin, Blaney, probably not Blaney, actually, Kyle Busch, Chase Elliott, Bowman and Byron and Logano, I would consider. I don't think this sets up very well for him to win the championship. I could definitely be wrong. I mean, if I find Blaney at 20-1 or something like that, sure, yeah, absolutely. But, I think Truex, Hamlin, obviously. And then Kyle Busch and Chase Elliott obviously have legit paths and are favorites outside of Kyle Larson. And then I think Phoenix is good for Bowman. He's had some good results at Phoenix. He's dominated a race at Phoenix before. And, you know, the 550s in Texas and Kansas should be good for him as well. And same for Byron. Like, I think Byron and Bowman are legitimate contenders for the championship. And then, of course, Logano, as I've mentioned as well. If he can get through by winning at the tracks he needs to win, mm-hmm. Phoenix is in play for him. I do think, yes, Phoenix is in play for him. So I just have a hard time with Keselowski, Bell, and Harvick as championship contenders, given Keselowski's dead to me. And Bell and Harvick are just, they haven't shown anything this year. Zero stage wins, I was going to say, combined, and one most laps led between them combined, and one win between them combined. Just not looking good for Bell or Harvick, and Keselowski's dead to me. So, that's where we are. Yeah. But I honestly don't think Blaney's a championship contender right now, given just Phoenix's, it's an okay track for him, but it's not a great track for him. And I don't think necessarily that he's just dominant enough. Yes, he's won three races this year, but one of them was Atlanta. One of them was Michigan. Both of those are intermediate tracks. Mm-hmm. And the other one was the super speedway race. And that's not what this championship's going to come down to.
Has there been a race this year that Ryan Blaney's led the most laps? Like, I'm with you at 14 to one. He's too short for me. I'd hit that at 22, probably.
Right. He's won some stages. He won the first stage and the second stage at Martinsville, but he didn't even lead the most laps at that race.
Yeah. I'm with you on Logano. You can get him at 19 to 1 on FanDuel right now, which I think is very, very good value. He led the most laps at Phoenix earlier this year. He's always been really good at Phoenix. He can win Martinsville. I think hitting Logano right now at 19 to 1, he can win Talladega. I think that's very good value heading into this weekend. And Byron 30 to 1. Those are the two best values out there now. Chase Elliott, if you think Chase Elliott's going to legitimately contend, 10 to 1 at BetMGM right now is probably as short as he's going to get unless he runs into issues. So if you do want to get on the Elliott train, I'd recommend, I did yesterday. I grabbed some Elliott, not a ton, but I did. Going back to, I know I'm kind of jumping all over the place here, but what was I gonna say? Can you read my mind yet?
The old train of thought disappearing, riding off into the sunset there.
I got it. I know it. So speaking of William Byron, you know, he's up to 30 to 1, even Alex Bowman. So you always have to consider this scenario. What if Kyle Larson and Chase Elliott don't make it to the final four and William Byron is the only Hendrick car in the final four? You're telling me I'm acting as someone that is like thinking of, well, I don't think Byron's a good bet. The Hendrick car at Phoenix, if he's the only Hendrick car, you'd kill for 30 to 1. So, I think he can contend even if Larson and Elliott are in that race. So, yeah, all that quickly, or not even quickly, but roundabout says that Byron 30 to 1 points bet. I'm pretty sure he's still available there. If not, you can get him at 25 to 1 on BetMGM. I don't think I'd go much shorter than that. Would you? I mean, you would. I personally wouldn't.
I mean, I still like 17 to 1. If your prior 17 to 1 was good for him, I think it's still good value. I mean, where is the bad track for Byron in the rest of this season? There isn't one.
He could win this weekend.
All the 550s are just fine for him because Hendrick has that horsepower at the 550s. Martinsville, he finished fourth earlier this year. I was trying to look at his Martinsville history. He's had an eighth. He had a second place in 2019. the Charlotte Roval, he's finished sixth and sixth in the last two Charlotte Roval races. Phoenix, I mean, he's been pretty good at the short flats. He's won in the Xfinity Series at Phoenix and at Iowa. He's won in the Truck Series at Iowa and New Hampshire. You know, he's had some good short flat finishes this year. He finished ninth at Phoenix last year and 10th. He finished eighth earlier this year at Phoenix. All these tracks are good for him. I would definitely, I still would bet him at 17-1. I still would. But obviously if you can find better, and you can, I would bet that too.
Yeah. Here's a question that you already know the answer to, because I'm asking it at this point, but it's a stat that I think deserves being pointed out. Second best average running position in the 550 package this year. Second most fastest laps. Who is it? William Byron, which is impressive to say the least.
Remember going into the playoffs, we said he was what, third or fourth or something in green flag speed for the whole year.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. That was that him overcoming a track, Bristol, that he historically was not great at in any series, and finishing top five and getting into that next round definitely showed. I don't think it should. It's hard to say that it showed playoff or championship caliber this year. Certainly possible with the speed, but overall into the future, that is the sign of a championship driver, is someone that gets it done like that. And absolutely. Honestly, I know you don't see Blaney challenging, but I'm kind of seeing the same thing with Ryan Blaney and you know how he ran at Richmond and is just running now. I think that team's hitting their peak, and I kind of like it. I don't like him at 14-1, but he's like a sneaky play to me. I don't know why.
I understand that. I think a lot of it, I think a lot of it is recency bias. He won those races. He had a second place. You know, he finished fourth at Bristol, which is a good track for him. But he still wasn't good at Darlington. It was his best Richmond ever, but it was still 10th. I'm not there with Blaney. Where has the dominance been? Like you said, no races this year has he led the most laps. The number of stage wins, 1, 2, 3, 4 stage wins all year. You know, granted, William Byron's only had 3 stage wins all year. So, but he has led the most laps, at least in one race this year. So, plus, I just think the tracks set up better for William Byron than they do for Blaney, especially Phoenix. Now, the other thing is, like, yeah, William Byron didn't run very well at Richmond, but Richmond of the short flats, it's like Blaney. Richmond's his worst one by a good amount. It historically has been in the Cup Series for him, and it historically was in the Xfinity Series for him as well, his worst track of the short flats. So he made it through Richmond. Of course, the Darlington DNF is a Darlington DNF. That's not really representative of how he could or may have run. But then he was awesome at Bristol. And again, I go back to top 3, 4, 5, whatever it is in green flag speed this year going into the playoffs. The dude's a contender, and Blaney was not up there. Blaney was much further down. I think he was in 11th or 9th or something like that in green flag speed for the whole regular season, much lower than Byron.
Mm-hmm. One note about Blaney in Darlington, he was actually a lot better than his 22nd place shows. He was like an 8th place car all day. He spun late.
That's true. But, yeah. You know, it's still, I'm not there on Blaney. He's been running better. But I don't think if you put him at Phoenix against 3 other playoff, you know, drivers who've been awesome all year, I don't think he outruns them.
I can't articulate a good argument against that, but I just, I like looking at everything, you know, every underdog angle and all that. That's why
does have 2 third place finishes at Phoenix. The problem was there in 2019, the high downforce here.
Uh-huh.
His low downforce, 23rd, 17, 16, 34, which is again representative, 37 again, not representative. 6, that's like the upside there, and 10.
Yeah, those championship cars only get an extra 50 horsepower, not an extra 100. So, anyway, we are off to Vegas this weekend for the South Point 400. Kyle Larson won this race earlier this year, as I said before. He's also on the pole this weekend. Over the last seven Vegas races, we got Logano with 2 wins. Truex has got a win. Larson has a win this year. Keselowski has a win. Harvick has a win. Kurt Busch has a win. It's weird because every time we come to Vegas, I feel like Penske just has something figured out. And actually, before we dig deeper into this, I'm going to talk quick about sports books and, again, shopping around. So if you are on NASCAR Twitter, you noticed a lot of people jumping at a couple numbers earlier in this week. So Bet Rivers likes to post odds. Like, they're determined to be the first one to put out NASCAR odds, and they're not sharp. So
no,
they're not sharp at all. Like, they had Larson as the heavy favorite at Richmond, which didn't make sense. That's where I grabbed, I think, Truex at like 7-1. But mm-hmm. So they opened Vegas. They opened Kyle Busch at 12-1. Which, if you know me, I don't like betting outright winners very much, but I immediately ran over to Indiana to grab that because that is just absolutely insane value. Kyle Busch, 12-1. He has not won at Las Vegas, but he's been so good. He has won at Las Vegas. He does have one win here. Sorry. He's been so good at the 550 package and at mile and a half this year that was just an automatic bet. As well as Blaney is available at 17-1. Like I said, Penske's really good here. Blaney, very good in this package, very good at mile and a half. But again, not only shop around, but pay attention to early lines. We see movement. So what happens with when Bet Rivers opens like this? They'll be up for a day. So you'll have like basically a full day. We actually saw this week, though, DraftKings came in and opened super early. They're usually the latest. They opened quite early. And what happens is Bet Rivers usually opens with a couple, 3-4 drivers that are just off and you just know it. And then DraftKings and the other sharper books come out with their odds and Bet Rivers adjusts. So the time to grab that value is literally pretty much as soon as it opens. And so just keep that in mind. It's kind of like DraftKings when they open their top 20 lines. You have to, if there's some that you like, you need to grab those as soon as possible because they move so quick. We saw Austin Dillon go from like minus 140 to minus 280, I believe, within the span of 30 minutes of these lines opening. Like, you need to hammer these quick. And yeah, that's my rant for Vegas and betting. Now, let's talk about the actual race. Larson on the pole. He's the heavy favorite by books. The longest you can get him is plus 370 over at FanDuel, who, by the way, I have to give FanDuel a shout out. And we haven't talked about this. I know we're going to eventually, the different books and their lines. Typically, FanDuel has the best lines when it comes to outright winners. This week, of the top 14 or 13 favorites, they have the longest odds of all but one of them. They are It's like that most weeks. Caesars is typically the worst. DraftKings is actually typically the worst when it comes to outrights, but FanDuel is, for the most part, very generous. That's the best word I can come up with here. Generous with their lines. So if you're betting, you know, not to favor any book here, but you have to shop around for lines, and FanDuel is typically the best. But we got Larson at plus 370. You can grab Kyle Busch now. Down to plus 700, still Bet Rivers with the best odds. Hamlin, Elliott, Truex, you can get Hamlin at 750, plus 750, Elliott at 9-1, and Truex at 10-1. Do you think Larson is the favorite by everyone? Larson's the favorite by my algorithm. There's obviously other betting values out there, but if nothing crazy happens in this race, do you think what's the chances you think of people beating Kyle Larson, who, by the way, this week has a badass paint scheme, who won here in March, led the most laps, led 103 laps, had a near perfect driver rating. Larson gonna win this race again and grab some more playoff points, or you think it's gonna be a little bit closer than a lot of people are thinking as of now on Tuesday?
Yeah, I think that's I think it's a good question. If you look at the 1.5 mile low wear tracks this year, Kyle Larson dominated Vegas, most laps led, won stage two, won the race. Then we go to Kansas, most laps led, won stage two, probably would have won the race without all that crazy caution stuff. Didn't hold off Kyle Busch on those restarts. Kyle Busch won stage one there and won the race. Then the only other low wear 1.5 mile track we've had, Charlotte, won stage one, won stage two, won stage three, most laps led, won the race, Kyle Larson. So this is Kyle Larson's time to shine. I don't think it's a slam dunk. I mean, we saw what happened at Kansas. Boy, it's going to be hard to beat him. The problem for me is there's so many drivers that are actually in good shape for this race. I think this sets up well for a lot of drivers. We talked about how Vegas is a great track for Blaney, great track for Alex Bowman, great track for Chase Elliott. I think Truex at night, you know, going into twilight there, this is a good track for him. He won this race 2 years ago. So I think there's like, obviously, Kyle Busch at these low wear 1.5 miles has been very good. So I think there's a contingent set of drivers, I don't even know if I use the word correctly, that could potentially win here, keep pace with Kyle Larson, keep it close, which is why I actually think Kyle Larson's odds are pretty fair. I'm not jumping out of my seat to bet Kyle Larson at 370 on FanDuel. Which is, like you said, the longest that he is currently. But I think maybe betting him 370 at FanDuel is not a bad like cover bet. Maybe you bet a couple outrights that you like, whether mm-hmm. it's Kyle Busch at 12-1, or you know, for me, I really like Bowman at 21. Blaney's 17 at FanDuel, and I think I like Truex 10-1 at FanDuel. So let's say I make those three bets, hypothetically speaking, and then I think Kyle Larson's a great cover bet. So you basically bet Larson enough units to cover and make your money back from what you would have lost betting those other three outright bets. So I think that's a potential play this weekend. And notice all of those lines are on FanDuel. Like you said, they just have some amazing lines this week. They typically do. I know in Vegas, the lines are kind of all over the place. Westgate tends to be a little more generous because a lot of books will take Westgate because they're the opener there and take Westgates and just kind of like shave 10% off of them or something like that. So Vegas can be like that, but I really think Circa has the sharpest lines because they really bring down the favorites. The longer odds, people tend to be much longer odds. But what I do find is of the longer odds drivers, the ones that are shorter than you'd expect are the ones that we typically think our models would typically find as better as well. So just an example at Circa this week, Kyle Larson plus 270. That's even shorter than BetMGM, which you have on your little thing you tweeted out before we went live on the podcast. They have Kyle Busch at plus 500, which again would be the shortest of all those listed. So they really brought down the favorites. But then somebody like Truex is 9-1. You know, somebody like who's a name that I didn't really mention up there? Let's say Kevin Harvick.
What about William Byron?
Well, I was going to say Kevin. Well, I wanted to get to Byron in a moment. Kevin Harvick, they have at 13-1, even longer than FanDuel, because they just don't see Harvick doing well here. And I don't either. I mean, there's zero chance almost for Harvick to win. William Byron, they have at 10-1. And Alex Bowman, they have at 20-1, which I was shocked by. I was shocked they have Bowman at 21 because I thought he'd be more like Byron at 10-1. So definitely was a little surprised there. I think, you know, but by and large, the longer shot drivers, I think they tend to be pretty sharp. Like, for example, they have Ryan Blaney, kind of in the middle of the pack here at 14-1. I know you said Caesar has him at 10-1, but of the non-Caesars, 14 is the shortest. So, you know, if we look at any other like longer shot drivers, there isn't a whole lot that's going on here, but I was surprised by William Byron. I actually thought they'd have Bowman even shorter. You know, they definitely seem to have sharper lines. One thing I think is interesting, they have Joey Logano at 20-1, longer than FanDuel by a lot. You know what I mean?
Wow.
But I think it makes sense. Is Joey Logano going to win these 550s? No, he's been terrible at the 550s this year, relatively speaking. What has he done at the 550s this year? Especially the mile and a half. Ninth at Las Vegas, nowhere close to the lead. Charlotte, 17th. And what's the other one? Oh, Kansas, 17th, right? Like, I think their lines are sharper. Like, Logano should not be where all these other books that you tweeted out, anywhere from 11 or 10 to 13. He should be more like 20-1. Mm. I think Circa has really sharp lines, but that Bowman 20-1 still sticks out to me as not the sharpest line. But Bowman 21-1 at FanDuel, I really like.
Yeah, I said wow because if you remember back to the Kansas race last year, I think I grabbed Logano at 17-1 for that race. And that was, you know, my whole mindset there was he started second. He had the best average running position on low wear mile and a half last year. He just never got a win. And that was the race that he got the best restart on Kevin Harvick. Harvick wasn't able to pass because you can't pass with this package. And
right.
I cleaned up that day. I also had him parlayed with an underdog money line football bet that just, I think I got like 50-1 or something odds. But that goes back to this package and where we could see Kyle Larson lose this race is where we've seen Kyle Larson lose this race this year. And that's the final restart. I think whoever leads on the final restart on Sunday night, which by the way, this race is Sunday night, not Saturday night. I think that's who's going to win it because you can't pass in this 550 package. And it's unfortunate, but I think it's worth checking into who's fastest on restarts on these mile and a halves in this package here at Vegas.
Yes.
It's a stat that you should definitely pay attention to. Guys like Matt DiBenedetto are very good on restarts. Is Matt DiBenedetto going to win this race? No, but he could finish top 10. He could easily get up there because he's so good on these restarts. Whereas a guy like Chase Elliott typically struggles on restarts. I still think Chase Elliott can win. I think if it's a race that goes green long, that he could have the best car and win. But he does struggle on restarts.
By the way, when Rick Allen said Chase Elliott is so good on restarts this past weekend, I thought of you.
Oh, when did he say that? Was I?
I can't remember. By then? Probably. I don't know. There was at one point, he was like, oh, Chase Elliott is, you know, really good on restarts. I can't remember the exact terminology, but I was like, Jordan would definitely disagree. And the fact that it's Rick Allen is extra disagree.
Yeah. Oh, but I'm surprised that I didn't hear. I was so King of the Speedway. I was a nervous wreck. And the amount of beer that I drank during that race, it's been a while since I've put down that many beers. And
I don't blame you.
Especially when the race was, like you said, was going so well for me. And I was just enjoying it and they tasted good. I think I tweeted out, you know, like an hour before the race, like, oh, beers are going down good. And they never stopped going down good the entire night. But
I know you got your rant about the back marks and all that jazz. And I know it doesn't have to do with King of the Speedway just in general. But dude, you honestly, like legitimately, honestly had at worst a third place lineup based off of speed in that race. I guarantee if we look at green flag speed and look at those lineups, you probably had a top three at worst based off of green flag speed. Cause obviously, you know, you can adjust for starting position and whatever and salary how you want, but you still have to fill a salary cap. So you're not everybody's going to sit there with the top five cars or top six cars or whatever. But it showed, because from midway through stage one until the shit hit the fan in stage three, like halfway through, you were in the top three the whole race, barring, you know, something happens under pit stops and it gets shaken up and whatever. But like Blaney was fast, Elliott was fast, Larson was fast. Those were your three dominators. And you had three place differential guys. You had Corey LaJoy, who moved up, constantly moved up throughout the whole race. You know, I mean, he started 31st, he got up to 27th, and things happened. I think he finished a little better than that. I can't remember his exact finishing position, but that's not the point. But like, he was moving up the whole race. Corey LaJoy did. And I just pulled it up here. He finished 26th. And then you had Ryan Preece, who was way up there at certain points in the race in the teens. And he did finish 17th, which I actually think was an unflattering result for him, given he was racing as high as, you know, 12th or 14th at certain points. But, the dude started 27th. He was $6,000. And it was crazy because Bubba Wallace started 28th, one spot further back, but he's $1,500 more expensive than Ryan Preece. And that's where you and I, when we were talking, I was like, I can't justify Bubba Wallace at that price. Yes, Bubba Wallace finished 16th and started 28th. So he got four more fantasy points, or whatever it was, two or four more fantasy. I can't even do the math right now. Two more fantasy points than Ryan Preece, maybe. Whatever it was, two or four. It's not enough to justify $1,500 salary difference. So, yeah. Unless you found a lineup that had both Priest and Bubba, I couldn't justify Bubba. So I'm glad you didn't go with him. But dude, your lineup was so good and you just got hosed by the randomness of Bristol. So sorry, that's a totally random event. And another little random thing I was thinking about, cause we're previewing Vegas to kind of get wrapped back here full circle. I was talking about how Circa's lines are pretty sharp. And one driver I wanted to preview for Las Vegas is a guy who's run really well at these 550s. And this also ties into the Joey Logano point earlier, but Austin Dillon's been awesome at these 550s this year. Awesome at the 550s. Finished 12th at Vegas, 6th at Atlanta, which of course is higher wear. I should say 12th at Homestead, higher wear, and differently shaped. It's not one of the tri or quad ovals. But still, right now we're talking a worst finish of 12th. Then we come to Charlotte. He finished 6th. Sorry, Kansas, he finished 10th. So that's a top 10 right there. The Atlanta, he finished 6th. Charlotte, he finished 6th. And then the next one after that, Atlanta, 12th. So his worst finish at the mile and a half 550s this year is a 12th place finish.
Mm-hmm.
And now we're coming to Vegas. And of the low wares, he's finished 12th at Vegas, 10th at Kansas, and 6th at Charlotte. So those are the low wares. And the best one was Charlotte, 6th place, finished at night, right? Coca-Cola 600. Mm-hmm. Well, Vegas is going to finish in twilight. Austin Dillon's plus 200 for a top 10 on DraftKings, by the way. But if you look at outrights, he's longest on FanDuel at 55-1. He's 50-1 on DraftKings, but the sharpest one, in my opinion, the sharpest one, Circa, he's 45-1, which is where he's the shortest. And I think Circa is the sharpest. So I think that makes the most sense. So I like the 2-1 top 10 odds on Austin Dillon a lot this weekend for Las Vegas.
You know, I, speaking of him, also the most recent, and this race isn't super comparable, but the most recent 550 intermediate track was Michigan, and he had a legitimate top three mm-hmm. car in that mm-hmm. race before he got turned into a wall. So yes, I'm kicking myself very hard. Because like I said, Austin Dillon opened at like minus, I think it was minus 140 for a top 20. And I didn't grab it. I was so gung-ho on Chris Buescher, who also has very, very good stats in the 550 package. Has zero top finishes outside of the top 20 in the 550 package this year. I was super gung-ho on him, but Austin Dillon has moved to, I believe, minus 280 for a top 20.
I'm looking at minus 250 right now on DraftKings.
Yep, you're right, you're right. Yep.
Minus 250. I'd probably still bet that, honestly.
I wish we could parlay these. DraftKings, please let us parlay these, because Austin, like, Buescher's still at minus 165. Stenhouse, who's very good at Vegas and the 550 package, is minus 110. Like, there's a ton of value on top 20 bets this week.
Well, you know, honestly, what we're naming? We're naming Buescher. We're naming Austin Dillon. We've talked about how Kyle Larson's dominated this year. The Chevys have made a lot of gains at the 550s this year. Kurt Busch winning Atlanta, right? Like, the Chevys have made a lot of gains. And that's why you look at Joey Logano, you say last year at Kansas he won. And he's had great results at Las Vegas the past 2 years until his first Vegas race this year, relatively speaking, wasn't as good. He finished ninth compared to the previous years. The Fords have lost some ground compared to the Chevys at these 550s. I think the Toyotas are kind of still where they are, but the Fords have definitely lost ground compared to the Chevys. And that's why I can't justify Logano at 13-1 or 10-1 or any of these things. That's why he's 20-1 at Circa, is because 2019, 2020, different beasts. The Chevys have made up so much ground with that combined power of the Childress and the Hendrick engine shops, whatever, working together now, providing one Chevy engine. That has produced so much better results. We saw it at the very end of last year, and it's played out all through this year since they announced that alliance. The 550s, Chevy has made massive gains at the expense of the Fords mostly. I think, you know, obviously Toyota's made some gains as well, but I think it's come at the expense of the Fords. I do think Ryan Blaney has been the strongest of those at the 550s, and that's why I'm still good with Ryan Blaney as a contender for the win, obviously. But we're mostly talking with these value bets, Chevys, maybe Toyotas, and Ryan Blaney. And so it makes sense to me that Logano's 21, even though he's had really good 550 results last year, year before, especially at Vegas. I'm just not seeing the strength there this year from Logano and the Fords as a whole.
You know what's funny? I've been getting a few DMs since we started recording this, and a recent one I just got. Hey, quick question. Logano and Kez at both 20 at Circa, feel like I got to play Joey there. I just thought it was funny. I literally read that as I was listening to you saying how it wouldn't be a good bet. So going to tell him to listen to this week's episode.
I didn't say it's a good bet. I think it makes the most sense that he's 20-1 there, because, you know, he's 10-13 everywhere. I think 20-1 is the fair odds for him. You know what I mean?
Okay.
So I don't think it's a bad bet. I just think, I think those are his fair odds. Like, I think 13-1 is a terrible bet on Logano. And that's the best that you'd posted on your little spreadsheet thing, which is at FanDuel. So compared to all those other places, yeah, it's a good bet, but I think those are the fair odds on Logano, approximately speaking. And you know, we'll see what my model says. I know you have your model. I haven't run mine yet, but I'm expecting Logano will probably not pop very well given what we've seen at the 550s this year. Especially the low wear 550s. Well, I mean, he hasn't been great at the high wear either. But I think 20-1 is probably fair for Logano.
Logano's ninth on mine, just for reference. But one Ford that hasn't seemed to struggle as much in the 550 package is Ryan Blaney. He's been a constant top five threat in this package. Mm-hmm. Do you like his odds at 17-1 at FanDuel as much as I do?
Yes, definitely. I like Blaney a lot more than Logano. Mm-hmm. And it's, I don't know, maybe it's something about the driving styles or the way that they've adapted this year, but Blaney, also just at Vegas, Blaney's been really good. I mean, so is Logano, but Blaney's been consistently good, whereas Logano kind of struggled a little more this year at Las Vegas. But, you know, Blaney did great there. He's had some good runs at Atlanta, which is higher tire wear. I think I prefer Blaney at 17 than Logano at 20, believe it or not. I don't think Logano at 20 is a bad bet, but I prefer Blaney at 17 to Logano at 20.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. The results and the, you know, just performance overall this season points to Blaney. Definitely have a better, significantly better shot, I think, than Logano to win here on Sunday night. I mean, you look at the 550 package this year, Logano's best finish is seventh, and that was at Pocono. And you can't even compare Pocono to, Las Vegas. He finished 17th at Charlotte, 15th at Atlanta, 9th in the first Vegas race. You know, he's
29th at Homestead, you know, or sorry, that was Blaney. Logano, 25th at Homestead. And I that's probably an unflattering finish, but I don't think he ran that well either. But, you know, when I say I'd rather have Blaney at 17, that's because he's 14 at Circa, you know, like, and I do think Circa has sharper lines. Like I've mentioned, they much better match up with what my model produces than some of these other books. So 17's value on Blaney. Yeah, 20's value on Logano because he's the longest there, but I think it's value compared to what? Compared to FanDuel, compared to Caesars, compared to DraftKings. But I actually don't think it's value because the sharp book has him at 20 and the sharp book has Blaney at 14. But you can grab Blaney at longer than the sharp book, and you can't grab Logano at anything longer than the sharp book.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's my personal opinion, what I've seen based on my model and what I've seen based off of the statistics I'm looking at for this race.
And that is, I perfectly agree with that. One guy that might surprise you that doesn't have the finishes in this package this year is actually Chase Elliott. Mm-hmm. He ended up second at Charlotte. That's his best finish. He was fifth at Kansas. Every other finish in the 550 package this year has been outside of the top five. And I bring this up because this is another message that I'm getting a lot today. I don't know if you're getting this, but people like to send me lines that they think are good. And I'm like, thanks. What do you want me to do with this? But Chase Elliott over Kevin Harvick at Caesars plus 120.
Chase Elliott plus 120 versus Kevin Harvick?
Yes.
I think you have to take Elliott. Like, just smash that.
Max bet $100. I will note that, so Harvick was 10th at Charlotte, 2nd at Kansas, 5th at Homestead. And then
I much more care about the low wear tracks, right? So Vegas, right. Charlotte, 20th at Vegas, 10th at Charlotte, 2nd at Kansas, which was had all the mayhem at the end. He was not a top two car there. Right. You know, he was a 5th or 6th place car, I think, at Kansas, and benefited from all the late restarts. I would smash Chase Elliott at plus 120 versus Kevin Harvick because I more care about the low wear tracks. I care much less about the high wear tracks, and I especially much less care about Homestead, which is not even the same shape as these other mile and a half. So I definitely, you know, maybe we can throw Michigan in there. Let's throw Michigan, which is a 2 mile, but 550 lower wear. Harvick 14th, Chase Elliott 8th, and led one of the stages as well. So give me Chase Elliott plus 120 all day there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And the reason I keep mentioning some of these tracks is because my spreadsheet that I have open right now is the 550 package overall. So I'm just looking, you know, just at these 9 races, but that's just one thing I noticed was Chase Elliott and struggling a little bit, I would say, compared to expected performance, but his average running position in this package isn't awful. Like I said, it's Larson and Byron that are up top in that statistic.
Let's just compare Circa odds. Chase Elliott plus 750 to win, Kevin Harvick plus 1300 to win.
Yeah.
You know, I'm sure that's what my model would spit out as well. Chase Elliott should be favored in that matchup. So if you can get him plus one, plus anything, I mean, I would take a minus 110 versus Harvick. Yeah.
Yeah. I think it's a promotion because
it's gotta be. It's gotta be.
Yeah, because it says max $100 bet. So that's promotion. But
okay.
Hey, when they offer those promotions like that, and there's you have to. Just like, you know, they had our FanDuel had Larson at plus 200 for a top three last weekend, and or maybe it was plus 250, but either way, like I said, I always tweet stuff out, hey, bet this, because you know it's very good value when they do that. looking at, you think there's going to be, you think there's any way a non-playoff driver comes up here and wins this thing Sunday night? Or are we past that stage outside of Talladega where this is playoff drivers from here on out?
It's very rare that a non-playoff driver wins. I think we've had one non-playoff driver win in this current format in the playoffs. I can see it happening if it was something like a late restart situation like we had at, you know, Kentucky last year with Custer. But I think it would be maybe somebody more like Austin Dillon or Kurt Busch. But, you know, does Kurt Busch count as a non-playoff driver now that he's out, I guess? You know, he did make the playoffs, but I could see it happening. I don't think it's a slam dunk, but I could see it happening. You know, it's certainly not out of the realm of possibility, but if it did happen, I think it would probably be a Chevy, maybe an Austin Dillon or a Ricky Stenhouse. If it wasn't, you know, like I said, Kurt Busch, potentially a Chastain, potentially a Reddick. And if it wasn't a Chevy, it would probably be Buescher or DiBenedetto.
Mm-hmm. Here's how I see it playing out. So we've seen multiple times Larson's a heavy favorite and he comes out and he's a dud. And then I think this happens a lot more than people realize. I don't think people are picking up on this, but Larson usually starts out a race not very good. And it takes till about the second stage before they get that car where he wants it. So I think we're going to see that this weekend as well, where he's not as strong early on and then dominates the second half of this race. And what I'm getting at here is if you are able to live bet it and you want to bet Larson, it might be better to wait until the actual race starts and bet him live or just not bet at all because the odds are so short. But I think it's going to be Larson in victory lane. I'd love to see Kyle Busch win it. I'd love to see Blaney win it just to benefit my wallet. But I think it's going to be very tough for Kyle Larson to not win this race. As I said before,
I think it's going to be tough to get really good odds on him just because he's going to be starting first, right? Like,
yeah.
Even if he's off, he's not going to be that off. He's going to be second or third, probably at worst, I would guess. You know, I mean, at Charlotte, he won stage one. He was good right off the bat at Kansas as well. He was good right off the bat at Vegas. So like these low wear mile and a half, he was good right off the bat. Maybe he didn't win stage one in those, but he was still right up there. And I think it would take something like much more significant for his odds to drop than for him to fall to second or third.
Mm-hmm. I get what you're saying. And plus, you know, it's playoff time and how much were they testing? And I mean, we both know that they were testing at Atlanta. Mm-hmm. Who's to say they weren't at other tracks as well. One guy that we have not talked about at all really tonight is your boy, Denny Hamlin.
No, we haven't talked about him.
He's finished top four in the last two Vegas races. He led 121 laps in this race last year. He led 47 laps here in the spring of this year. And that team is, you know, even at Bristol, he had a very good car again. Mm-hmm. He had a top three, top two car in every single race of the first round of the playoffs. There's no reason to think that Hamlin won't contend here on Sunday night. And his longest odds available are 750 that I'm seeing. I don't know what Circa has him at. But
I think Circa has him at, yep, 750.
Yeah. So maybe worth a shot. I can never bring myself to bet on Denny Hamlin.
I can't pull the trigger on Denny Hamlin at 750. I think it's fair. But and here's the thing. Denny Hamlin has won four of the six stages in the playoffs, if you count just stage one and two. If you include mm-hmm. the final stage, he's won five of the nine stages. So they are on a roll. Obviously, they've been really good this year. But they haven't been dominant this year at these mile and a halfs. You know, if you look at mile and a halfs, zero stage wins this year, whether it's low wear or high wear, He has not won a stage. He hasn't led the most laps at a mile and a half track. And if you throw Michigan in there as a, you know, a 550 as well, if you throw Pocono in there as 550s, I know the flat isn't as big a deal, but like, I don't think I see anything here at 550s, not counting, you know, the super speedways. I don't count those. I don't see anything at 550s to see that he's been dominant here. So, you know, plus 750 may actually be generous, even though it's the longest we've seen across all of the different books.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm right there with you. Like I said, I typically can't bet Hamlin just out of spite. And I don't see value in 750, but I could see him winning this race. As weird as that sounds, like,
yeah.
I could see him winning it, but I'm not going to bet it because there's not enough value in 750. I'll take my chances with Blaney at 17 and Kyle Busch at 12.
I still would prefer Truex given it's going into twilight. I still prefer Kyle Busch at the low wear 550s of the, you know, the Gibbs teammates there to Denny Hamlin. I'd like Denny's third in the pecking order for me of the Gibbs cars.
Mm-hmm. Truex is one that I just can't quite get my finger around just because he's so much better in the 750. But like you said, I mean, he's very, very strong here at Las Vegas. He's won multiple times. You always got to consider the night thing, which I know you don't do any articles anymore, at least this year. Doesn't it always feel weird, like pointing stuff out like that? It's like someone that probably doesn't follow NASCAR very much probably looks at that and they're like, what the hell are these people pointing out? But it's true. Like, he is better at night.
And it's an aerodynamics thing. At night, it cools off. The air gets denser. The downforce, that because the air is denser, you get more downforce on the car. And that extra downforce changes the way it handles, changes the way it drives. It tightens up a little bit. So all those things somehow, some way, seem to play into Truex's hands a little bit better at these tracks. And so, you know, that's like a real thing. You've got the auto owners club paint scheme thing. That's a thing. I don't know if it has to do with the sponsorship dollars going into that race or pure coincidence. I can't explain that one as well. But the night and day thing is a legitimate thing on how it affects the handling of the cars and how certain teams might set up cars or how certain drivers' driving style matches up with it better.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, gives more grip as well. Cooler
that
temps,
extra so. That extra downforce will give you more grip. Your car that would be pressed into the track more.
Yeah. And that would be, you know, I flash back to Martinsville earlier this year. That's when I hit that 8-1 bet on Truex to win that, because we had that red flag. It was, I knew it was going to end at night, and I'm like,
oh yeah,
Truex is better at night. And he ended up winning. And that's when I stone cold those beers in my living room. Just
absolutely.
So yeah, I would love to see a Martin Truex Jr. victory on Sunday night in Las Vegas. Maybe even live. I'm going to be out in Vegas this weekend, and I haven't decided if I'm going to go to the race or not yet, because I know this is getting off topic, but I've heard nothing but horror stories on trying to get back from the track, and I don't know if I want to deal with that.
It takes a long time, dude. It takes a long time. You've heard nothing but horror stories, and that's because it's nothing but horror stories. I've done it myself, and it takes a long time to drive back. You either have to leave early, or you have to plan to just stay in traffic forever, or you have to plan to just, you know, post race hang out in the parking lot for a while.
I actually looked into a private helicopter ride into the track. And it's only $500, and I'm kind of considering it. I'm not going to do it because that'd be a waste of money, but
if you had bet Austin Dillon top 20, you could have covered that.
That's true. If Chris Buescher finishes top 20 on Sunday, it covers that and
there you
more.
Go. There you go.
So, but if I pay for that and then Buescher wrecks out lap one, then I'm going to be, that's like double. Like,
yeah, yeah. Then you're extra in the hole.
but yeah, so we'll see. But yeah, that's interesting because, you know, like a lot of tracks, you hear the horror stories when they first open. And like, I went to the first Kentucky race and the parking situation was awful. And, the next year they had it completely figured out. It sounds like Vegas just can't figure it out because probably because there's just so much traffic, you know, and so many people that are going back to the strip itself, you know. And so, yeah, yep. It might be better for me to just watch it on TV, or I don't even think I could be able to find a sports book because, you know, they're charging $600 for a damn seat to sit at a sports book on football Sundays. So, yeah, we'll see. But
go to one of the smaller sports books in Henderson or something like that.
Mm-hmm. Could do that.
Watch. The problem is you're still going to be, it's just going to be mostly NFL. You know, find the one NASCAR TV.
Right. Can you please like put the NASCAR race on this 12-inch TV so I can see what's going on.
Exactly.
But yeah. I don't have anything else for this week. Do you got anything else?
I think we're good. It's, you know, I will say both you and I have been very successful at the mile and a half this year. Betting, you for DFS as well. Model, like, we've slayed the mile and a half this year. So I'm pretty excited. You know, the mile and a half, there's just so many of them, and they're the most classic kind of racing. The least amount of like shit happens. It's not a super speedway race. It's not a Martinsville or Bristol. Hell, it's not a road course. It's not a, you know, it's not even like a Dover or a Pocono. It's just a classic type of race. That's some of the most predictable, along with like your Phoenixes and Richmonds and things like that. So very, very predictable type of racetrack here, which usually has led to good things this year. So I'm looking forward to it. Plus, it's, you know, it's Vegas, baby. I love it.
Yeah. And like I said, this round is going to be so exciting. And this first race is could be the difference between making it to the next round and not for some of these guys.
Yeah, it's a massive race to win. A massive race to win.
Yeah. So before we sign off, who wins on Sunday night? Who you got?
I'm going to go with, man, I you just have to go with Kyle Larson. Dude's just destroyed these tracks, the low wear mile and a half this year. And it hasn't even been close. You have to go with Kyle Larson. Obviously, he might not, but there's a reason he should be the heavy favorite. And I just have a hard time seeing anybody be faster than him come the end of the race. I mean, you look at the one night race of those this year, Charlotte led every stage, including the race win. So Kyle Larson.
Yeah. As much as, you know, this reminds me of Bristol last week. And I saw some DFS providers saying, you know, maybe don't go with Larson. And it's like, when the numbers are screaming at you as much as they are, you just have to do it. And, you know, Larson won last week. The numbers are screaming yet again that Larson wins this week. As much as I'd love to see Kyle Busch or Ryan Blaney in victory lane on Sunday night, I think it's going to be Kyle Larson. My algorithm agrees, and I'm going to roll with that. And I will be back next week. I know you're going to be busy, so I'm going to have to find a replacement for you.
Yeah, I know. But it's like maybe you can get Kaz Grala to fill in or something because he replaced Austin Dillon last year and kicked some ass. So if you can find the Kaz Grala equivalent to RotoDoc, I might be out of a job. You know, I might not be able to come back. No, I'm just kidding. Austin Dillon got his job back, and he's kudos to him. You know, he didn't make the playoffs, but he's actually been running pretty well. So, you know, he had a strong year. The problem is he's still in that darn second tier equipment, and his teammate is a little better than him. But he has actually, I think for him, maybe had his best cup year just in terms of raw performance. I know he didn't make the playoffs. He's had some wins, some fluky. Most fluky, but he has had a good year. But you know, maybe I'll have to step up my game after whatever replacement you get here. Nah, we'll see. But I think you're going to have a fun show next week with whoever you get. So we'll see. But yeah, I do have some things going on, so I will not be able to take the reins. Real quick, one last stat. Kyle Larson, 103 laps led at Las Vegas, 132 laps led at Kansas, 327 laps led at Charlotte. But if you convert that into percentage of laps led, he has averaged 56.6% laps led in the three low wear mile and a half races. So that's my parting stat.
And he's on the pole this weekend. So Kyle Larson, see you in victory lane on Sunday night. That's all I got.
All right. See you guys. Have a great weekend, everybody.